So there's a lot of confusing and conflicting information out there about coronavirus and COVID-19.
I saw this thing going around where if you hold your breath for 10 seconds and don't feel discomfort, then you don't have the virus.
I've been hearing like a lot on social media about like homemade hand sanitizers and homemade disinfectants.
I'm hearing like a lot of stuff like the flu kills 50,000 people a year, but yeah, like the flu doesn't shut down society.
And I'm genuinely wondering, like, can you carry the virus on like your clothing?
So today, I'm talking to a public health expert to set the record straight on some of your most burning COVID-19 questions. What's up, everybody? It's me, Myles, back again at my house, you know, just social distancing. You see here, I'm just reorganizing my t-shirts because I don't really have anything better to do these days. But that's not what this video is about. I crowdsourced some of your COVID-19 questions and we're going to answer them today and give you tips on how to figure out if what you're coming across is legit or not. And those people you saw at the beginning? Yeah, we teamed up with student reporters from PBS NewsHour Student Reporting Lab to bring you this episode. So let's get to it.
Is it true that having sliced red onions in your room will decrease the amount of germs or the infection rate?
No, it's not true.
Now that we've got that burning question squared away and I've removed all the onions from my room, I want to introduce you to Dr. John Swartzberg.
I'm a physician and I'm a professor at the University of California, Berkeley in the School of Public Health.
And what's really dope about him, he and I actually went to the same elementary school.
Did you go through the Oakland schools?
At first I did. I started out at Lakeview Elementary.
I went to Lakeview.
Oh, really?
In the early 1950s.
Wow. Okay.
Random, right? But let's get back to clearing the COVID-19 air.
You see a lot of young people that are, you know, thinking, oh, I'll be fine. So if I'm young, you know, I should be fine, right?
Now, worldwide, there have been rare deaths reported in people 19 or younger. So you can't be guaranteed that you won't get very sick. And a rare case, somebody may die. But the numbers after about age 19 start to go up. Not much in the 20s and not much in the 30s, but some people do get very sick and there have been deaths in those age groups. But when you get above 60, that's when the numbers really start to jump. Another thing for everybody, not just young people, to think about is if we get sick or if we get infected and even not sick, it's still possible for us to spread the virus to somebody else. And that somebody else could be someone who has a compromised immune system, somebody who has diabetes, or somebody who's over 65. These are people who wound up dying with this disease at a much higher rate.
And another thing that I've been seeing is, you know, people talking about like, oh, you know, doesn't the flu kill tons of people every year? You know what I'm saying? Why are we shutting down society for this virus, basically?
Right, well, flu does kill tons of people every year. The potential of this virus to kill even more tons every year is enormous. The estimates, if we don't do anything, would be horrific. We're talking about millions of people. So it's in anticipation of what will happen is why we act like we do.
One thing I was curious about is, you know, can it travel on your clothes and the reusable grocery bag? That's another one that I've been seeing a lot.
It can live on clothes. We haven't studied how long it can. It's important to think about the fact that if you touch your clothes, it's probably a good idea to wash your hands. If you've been around something where your clothes have rubbed up against something that could have the virus on it.
But, you know, there's people that think like, oh, if you wash your hands too much, doesn't that weaken your immune system? And then you have, you know, we're supposed to be washing our hands constantly for at least 20 seconds.
That idea is based upon a hypothesis that was raised decades ago called the hygiene hypothesis. And it suggested that if we live in too clean of an environment, our immune system doesn't get well enough educated to fight infection. And that may or may not be true. I think there likely are some kernels of truth in that. But the idea that washing your hands is going to impair your immune system, there's absolutely no evidence for that. We're getting exposed through our food and through what we breathe in to plenty of microorganisms to keep our immune system educated. So washing your hands on the other hand, does have benefits. If you've got the virus on your hands, the soap itself kills the virus, and the soap and water, when you run it under the faucet, the virus that's left on your hands goes down the drain.
Does that vitamin C cure COVID-19 or prevent you from getting it?
There's absolutely no evidence that taking vitamin C is going to prevent you from getting COVID or improve your recovery time. It's terribly important to eat foods that are rich in vitamin C because our bodies depend upon that for so many functions, including immune function. But you can get that from foods, and there's no reason to spend your money on supplemental vitamin C.
I've also seen people talk about liquid silver and also, you know, drinking alcohol, drinking liquor.
So people who drink a lot of alcohol, or even some alcohol, their immune system doesn't work as well. So my advice would be to avoid alcohol. And then you had about liquid silver. That one's dangerous. There's absolutely no evidence that it will protect you from getting any infectious disease, nor will it help you get well if you have one. More importantly than that, though, is the fact that people who take excessive amounts of this can do severe damage to their body. Their skin will turn a different color. It will impair a lot of bodily functions. So there have been people who have become very, very ill taking that.
What about like holding your breath for like 10 to 20 seconds? Does that mean you don't have COVID?
That recommendation is a myth, and people should not follow it.
Now, I could talk to Dr. Swartzberg all day, but as you can imagine, he's very busy. So we let him get back to other things, but I hope you learned something from him. Also, keep in mind, this is information that is available to us now, but we may learn something different in a few weeks, and that's okay. That's just how science works. We learn new stuff over time, and sometimes that information contradicts what was previously observed. That's a totally normal part of science. Now with COVID-19, scientists all over the world are working fast to try to learn as much as they can about the new virus and disease. And because of this gap in information, it totally makes sense that there's a lot of misinformation floating around the interwebs. So I'm going to leave you with some quick tips for how to evaluate if the information you stumble upon is legit or not entirely accurate. My biggest piece of advice, and this is what I do when I'm researching stuff and what professional fact checkers rely on, you got to read laterally. This means if you come across a story you're not sure about, you do some digging around it. Open up a new tab, you might Google the publication, Google the person being interviewed or the claim or the story itself. If there's a lot of legit news organizations or health organizations corroborating the claim, then it's probably good to go. But if you're not getting much from searching other sources or finding stories that refute the claim, then that's a red flag. And if nothing else is coming up about it, then that might mean that news and health organizations haven't had a chance to fact check it for you. Second thing, know who to trust. In general, the CDC, Johns Hopkins, and the World Health Organizations are good places to go if you're confused about medical advice you've come across. They've got up-to-date info on their sites. Just be wary of fake PDFs that look like they might come from one of these official sites. You know, go back to the actual site and see if you can find the information there just to double check. Another good source I go to fact check something is Snopes.com. They've got a team of fact checkers and journalists that investigate rumors circulating around the interwebs. And check out Poynter's COVID-19 misinformation website. It's a collab with fact checkers around the world to bust some COVID-19 myths. And last but not least, check out our Oldie But Goodie video about how to spot bad science reporting. Look how young I was. But dang, I'm insightful. That advice is still relevant today. All right, that's all I got for today. And that was exhausting. My brain hurts. But that's enough about me. We want to hear from you. Share something that you've come across online and debunked and how you knew it was a myth. I'm looking forward to see what you all got. Anyways, till next time, I'm your host, Myles Best. Peace out. Craving more COVID-19 info? Check out our latest video on the topic. And check out PBS NewsHour Student Reporting Lab's YouTube channel to see student journalism from around the country. And follow them on Instagram. They've got a lot going on there. While you're at it, show us some love by subscribing to our channel too. Till next time, y'all. Peace out.